Good morning, all of you. It is really my proud privilege to introduce today's chief guest, Sri Jayant Joshi, who is a stalwart in the field of IoT. Sri Jayant Joshi has completed his master's in business administration after completing his engineering and has a rich experience of 40 years. His key area of expertise is management systems consultancy to support corporate objectives to achieve operational excellence. He is a passionate entrepreneur for integrating business processes and technology with change management to improve profitability. His contribution to academia is also very remarkable. He is a member of Board of Studies for leading management institutes. He is presently designing a curriculum for the course covering emerging technology adoption in business to achieve excellence. He is a visiting faculty with many reputed management institutes like NITI, BMA, CII, IIMM, IPA, and many professional institutes. Sri Jayant Joshi holds trademark and copyrights for RESPA, R-E-S-P-A, Enterprise Solutions, with 500 man years of investment. He has the distinction of being an expert on the panel at Scale Up USA program, launched Dream LLC US. He has conducted many, more than 100 entrepreneurship development programs. He is presently working on the design of blockchain platforms for life science vertical to integrate artificial intelligence, IoT, to support industry 4.0 objectives. So it is my privilege to invite Dr. Sri Joshi to give his address.
Good morning, everybody. Respected Dr. Bedekar, dignitaries on to dais, and my friends. It's a good privilege given to me by VPM Polytechnics to come over here and share my views and ideas and my experience with you all people. As Madam has already explained you about the IoT, IoT is a growing area and it's not really an hype, actually. A lot of people may be thinking everybody is talking about IoT and all that. The wording given to the seminar is reconnecting the world is absolutely perfect, basically. Everybody is connected with the person to person, with already into the systems. But now, what is this reconnecting, actually? We are going to reconnect with the devices. And every individual has got a limitation of having the relationship or connecting with the number of entities or number of people. While connecting with the devices is going to give an immense opportunity. Today, the world population is around 7 billion. There are more than 50 billion devices which are there. So what really we are looking? We are really looking to connect with the devices. A step toward the connecting was basically with the Facebook. Now with Facebook and social medias, we are getting connected with many more people. Now how this can be really used to share our views, ideas, our expertise, with everybody. That is what is the thing which, you know, what I visualize it is reconnecting to the world, actually. Earlier, I know about maybe 40 years back when I was in Thana, I used to know only people in around Thana. Now today, I know everybody, not just locally, but globally. If you ask me, I know have a contacts with people in Europe, people in Africa, people in America, people in Canada. Now, this can be led further down by connecting to the devices, basically. I had an opportunity to attend India Economic Conclave on this 12th of December. And our Chief Minister, Mr. Devendra Fadnis, was there actually. The theme of that seminar was basically, what is the growth which is really required for India? India economy was around 1 trillion in 2007. Today we are talking about 2.6 trillion. If we are growing with the same GDP growth, probably we may achieve it 5 trillion by 2028. But our government objective is basically to achieve 5 trillion economy by 2025. Now the bifurcation of this 5 trillion, which is really expected, is basically maybe something in infrastructure, something in agriculture, something in services and all that. But the interesting thing is that 1 trillion is expected from digital economy. So everybody is talking about the digital. What is this digital? Digital is the next step of IoT. IoT is basically capturing the data, and digital economy is going to use that data into various applications, basically. Now, how this digital economy is going to help to the industry, to the people, to the well-being of the human beings and all that? That is what is the most important thing, actually. IoT, basically the sensors, is the thing which is a base which is going to capture the data. And that data is basically has normally moved into the three phases. The one phase is basically capturing the data. The next stage is basically communicating the data to the concerned people. And then the third stage is basically using that data for your decision making, basically. Now, what is this decision making? You know, in our everyday today life, actually, we are always taking up a decision. But today, our decision making is more based on to our memory. We really don't have a factual figures. The digital will really take all this data, put it onto information sheets, which is into a facts and figures, into a numeric values, which can really help you to take a correct decisions and all that, and actually. And this is where it can help. As Madam was mentioning it, that agriculture, the Mahindra tractors are connected with an IoT. Now this is what it really going to help the individuals to take a correct action. It's basically based on to the availability of weather, availability of resources to do that, when I should do a cutting of my farm products, how I'm going to transport those products, I'm going to pack the product, what is the market demand. So there are a lot of those considerations are there. Everything is becoming day by day more complex, actually. And this is where the need of IoT is really picking up and all that. And IoT is not just for the agriculture. IoT applications are there everywhere, actually, you know. Everybody must have seen the developments into the mobile technology. 5 years back, nobody was knowing about the smartphones. And today, everybody is using smartphone. And what is that smartphone? Smartphones are not just the phone, but it's taking your photos, it's sharing those photos. The WhatsApp is a wonderful application. About a year back, one of my friends had an emergency, and he needs to be operated on to a bypass surgery. And unfortunately, his doctor was in the US. What these people have done, they were taking up the photographs, sharing with the WhatsApp, going to the US, and then the doctor was advising it. And then the operation went very successfully. So these are the ways the technologies are getting adopted and all that, actually. So IoT is really opening up a number of opportunities, actually. It could be into your home security. About a month back, there was a presentation from the real estate person, and he was showing it how they have built up intelligent homes, actually. And he was giving an actual example. He was sitting it on a chair, and he says, open the curtains. And the curtains were getting opened up. And this is a real solution, which has actually has shown it, actually, that building is very much in Mumbai, actually. So these are the things which is really picking up. Our government is investing huge money onto the smart cities. Now, what is the smart cities? The city requires the resources like water, electricity, waste disposal, and all that, actually. Now, this is all is generating a huge number of data. Now, only thing is that this data is to be really taken up into a cloud system, and then that will be shared with the analysis and all that to the concerned authorities or something to take a corrective action. IoT is applicable to the logistic. Uber is the best example. What is that Uber has done? It's connecting your devices. It's picking up the data from the GPS, sending it to the cloud, and you're sitting at the customer and is sharing that where you are, how much more time you will require to reach it to the destination, how much money you will have to pay, all that is getting connected. In fact, that's a very interesting area for me, actually, and I wrote an article on Uberization into a supply chain management. It's basically somebody is placing you an order, you want to manufacture, you want to pack it, and you want to deliver it. That's a simple thing. But if you really start looking at it in detail, there are a number of activities are generating the data. And that data has to really get shared across the whole users, basically. So that they can really take a necessary corrective action. So IoT is a huge market opportunity, basically. Not just locally, but globally also. I remember it a couple of years back, if I have to make a call to the US and all, was a big challenge. Now with a Skype and with a WhatsApp, you can pick up phone. With a Skype and all that, you can have a video chat also, video call also. So that is how that whole technologies are changing it. So IoT is going to be a big opportunity. It's going to help in a digital economy. And IoT is really a base, basically, from where this whole information system or the data is really going to pick it up and all that. They say that today, 99% devices are not connected. It's only 1% which are really getting connected, actually. Some factories, we see it that data is captured and put it into a SCADA system and all that, actually. Even when we were developing it, enterprise applications and all that, we were looking at it, the whole information is into silos and it's not really getting shared up with across the organization. Things are changing, but the change is still very slow. It's still going to take a long time, actually. They say that by 2025, 2030, there are a number of devices will be there. By 2020 itself, they expect that there will be 50 billion devices which needs to get connected throughout the systems and all that. So this is what is the big opportunity about the IoT. Now, are we ready to take this opportunity? That's a big challenge, basically. As our Chief Minister said, 1 trillion will be a digital market. Are we ready to do that, actually? So what are those challenges are there? As a user, are we ready, basically? You must have seen even the smartphone penetration has also taken a long time. And still, we in a city, we find that, oh, everybody is using smartphone. But if you really look at it in the rural market, the penetration is still not there. And a lot of requirements are there into that, basically, because agriculture is there. And whatever we say, is India is an agriculture country. Our main contribution is coming from over there. So that's the opportunity, basically. Another thing is that basically when we talk about the IoTs and then its challenges, every industry vertical has got their specific business processes, actually. If you go to smart homes, their requirements will be different. If you move to smart cities, the requirements will be different. If you move to the industry, the requirements will be different. In the industry also, the small mid-sized industries and then big corporates, the requirements will be different. If you look at it at the engineering industry and process industry, the requirements are different, actually. Now, do we have the required skills to understand and contribute into this particular development? That's a big challenge. As I was mentioning about this India Economic Conclave, I had a privilege to listen to Dr. Raghuram Rajan also. He had, was connected from Chicago. And he said there's 5 trillion is acceptable, it's possible and all that. But where are our talents basically who are going to contribute into this achievement and all that? Now I'm very happy that VPM Institute had organized this type of programs actually. Because that's the need of the hour, basically. Because then more and more students, more and more academicians, more and more industry experts, they come together, they listen, they understand, and then they can develop the talent skills onto that, actually. Now, different types of talent skills are also required. I know I'm seeing a lot of students over there. They are all technology experts. But then only technology doesn't really help you. You need a industry background also, basically, because the domain is very important. I see the management institutes people are also over here, and they can collaborate and basically jointly work it out and all that, actually. Because when we talk about the management, basically, it starts from maybe your sales, administration, manufacturing, quality, maintenance, costing, profitability, and all these things. So IoT, whatever data it is getting captured, has to really help them to, you know, share all the data, actually. And this is where it's going to help it. And then, as I was discussing earlier, it's more onto the analytics, which is going to contribute it. And analytics is growing very fast. As I was discussing, analytics is going to help me to take a decision. What I have done it in last 5 years, maybe my health, maybe my insurance, maybe my telephone bills, if I see that data, if I see that analysis, I can take a necessary corrective actions and all that. Analytics is also moving in over 4 steps actually. The first step is basically capturing the data from the IoT devices. Next step is basically converting all this data into an information, basically. All information technology and all that, what is still a very basic thing. We only see the reports into a tabular form and some figures into this. We are getting so much of information every day that really, I don't know how CEOs are going to manage the data which is bombarding it. I'm getting 50 WhatsApp messages. I don't know how many messages I'll be able to see. So that's a big challenge, actually. So the next step is basically analyzing this information, which is basically to draw a predictive analysis, basically. This is what is happening, so this is what is likely to happen, basically. It could be my mobile bill, or it could be my insurance, or it could be my any other data. So the predictive analysis is going to be. Now, how this predictive analysis comes? There are different methodologies how you will do that predictive analysis. Are we going to stop at the predictive analysis? No. The next step is coming is a prescriptive. So when you expect this is what is predictive, what action I should take it as a prescriptive thing and all that. why I'm discussing all this is basically IoT is base, but then don't stop it at IoT. How you make effective use of IoT data onto your decision making to improve the whatever profitability, performance, well human being and all this is a big challenge and all that. The same analysis can be also considered it as a data information. And then the knowledge and the wisdom. You are generating your knowledge base based on to the information which you have received it and all that. And then you are going to take a next step of applying your wisdom to take a corrective action. So this is what is why I'm explaining all this is basically it's all based on to the IoT. So capturing that IoT data is a very important thing. As I was discussing, are we ready? Are we ready to know which data needs to be captured? Which is also a big challenge. For which, what sensors I'm going to use it? At what frequency I'm going to capture the data? These are all important factors. And these all things will come up if you are very clear with your objective, with your goals, what you want to achieve it and all that actually. Which is a very basic thing, and as I'm already interested in knowing what I want to achieve it, what is my vision? As government has identified that the vision is achieved to 5 trillion, it has to get it broken down to 1 trillion in digital. Now how that 1 trillion is going to come, what are the areas from where it's going to get captured and all. These are the factors which we'll have to really start looking and thinking about it. I think, I hope everything makes sense.
Yes,
because I see the faces are confused or something like that, basically, because I know I'm talking to more of a technology student, but why I'm talking about this more is basically to make them aware about, you know, the it's not just an hype, but basically it's going to be having a more demand onto that. So what is this IoT readiness, how that will come basically? You need to have a holistic approach, what I always talk about it is. Now what is this holistic? It's basically people, processes and technology. Now as we know, IoT is one part of the technology, but for me it's a third priority. For me, the first thing is that the people, because it's the people who are going to use the data. So they have to be very clear what they want it from the system, what they want it, what data needs to be captured. Because I'm very sure the technology expert can capture any data, but you are going to invest your money, time, efforts in capturing the data. So and we don't have ample resources, so we should really focus onto the data which is relevant to us and actually needs to be captured. And I'm sorry, but many people, they are not really very clear what data needs to be captured, basically. I'm talking more from my industry experience, basically, but which is a big challenge, actually. The CEO's requirements, expectations are something different. The general manager's expectations, requirements are different. The shop floor level persons, his ideas are something different. And they're all moving in a different directions, actually. So we have to really build up a conscious vision to focus on to this thing. Then from the people, once you are clear what you want to do, then you look at it at the next level of the processes, actually. I'm again sure, very confident that our technology will capture all the data. But then there are a number of devices are there, and then your processes are not standardized. That's another big challenge into the industry, actually. So your processes needs to be improved to make them ready to attach with an IoT devices and then capture the data. That's another thing, challenge. And then you come to the technology to, you know, identify the sensors and devices and that its relevance to capturing the data and all that. So this is it's a process, it basically. Another good opportunity recently, Again, I'm referring to the latest thing where I attended this India Economic Conclave. How many of you know SOFIA? Can you raise your hand? Oh, there are plenty of students. I had a good opportunity to see the SOFIA from 10 feet, actually. And the person who was designed, developed, and built at SOFIA, his name is David Hanson. He was there, and he gave a lecture for almost 45 minutes, how he initiated that idea, how he went on improving onto that, and what is the stage where SOFIA is there, and what are his future plans and all that. Now, why I'm talking about SOFIA is basically, again, it's a robotics. The robotics is, again, capturing the data from your sensors and all that. And to my surprise, the audience has asked two questions to SOFIA. What are those questions? Do you believe in God? Why you are woman? And to my surprise, even as a human being, I may not be able to answer those questions, but she has answered it. So you can imagine at what level we are moving, we can move that actually. So that IoT can also take you to robotics and all that. And this is what is the trend technology is going to move in the next 10, 20 years. So we have to really make a beginning and we have to start working on to that actually. Now, as I was mentioning about that, we need a integrated approach actually. It's basically, I always say that it's a technology plus talent takes to innovation. When I say talent is not only the people, but it's the people, processes, manpower, it's skills and all that actually. And what is that innovation requirement actually? As a SOFIA, it's a good innovation for me. Everybody's talking about disruptive technologies and innovations and all that actually. So that's an interesting area where IoT can really take you over there actually. And this innovation is only going to help you to improve your profitability, performance, well-being in the decisions and all that. You might have also heard about that Jack Ma. Sometime back, he made a statement that by 2025, everybody will have only 4 hours working. Rest of the time will be free, basically. Because technology will take over, it will share the data, it will do necessary actions, prompt actions. As you know, okay, we are moving to the technology, you give standing instructions to the bank, you make my this payment, make my that payment, banks is making it automatically and all that. So we are reducing our workload and all that. So as we go on moving up into a higher level, probably, we will still have plenty of time, but that has to really help you to improve the profitability and performance and build up that. That's what is my thing. So when we talk about all this, is basically as we were discussing the various components or something like that, which is really going to contribute into all these things. So collaboration between all this is really required. As I was talking about the holistic approach, I was talking about the different technologies and all that, they needs to get collaborated actually. Then only you will find a success and your goals will be achieved and all that. There are limitations also actually, because everybody has got a different strength and different weaknesses actually. Everybody is not expert in everything actually. So the new concept is coming up is called open innovation, basically. Now, what is that innovation, basically? And what is this openness? So starting from Microsoft to small companies, either in Pune or Thane, they also have a strength, but they also have a weaknesses, actually. So you need to really focus it out onto your strength, share with the different people, teams, companies, users, industries, and all that, to consciously work it out onto a goal. About a week back, there was a Japanese delegation, and they say, we need help from India. Now, we all may be thinking, Japan is a developed country, why they need help? So they say that, okay, we have a huge money into our account, but we don't have those skills, sufficient skills to use it and develop it and market it and implement it and train to the people and implement the system. So that is what is the thing which is really going to happen. So not just local, but global opportunities are opening up if you really think you can be open and start contributing into an innovation. This innovation will be based on to your creativity. Creativity will take you to disruptive technologies, and disruptive technologies is basically going to change the way we are working today. I'm very happy that VPM has already taken up a step to organize this IoT seminar, conference and all that, actually. Now what I suggest, it basically they can take a next step, collaborate with the management institute, so now there is a more better rapport of technology people understanding the management concepts. And then the next step can be actually a industry collaboration, basically. Because we think it many times, oh, this must be a problem, I can give this type of a solution. But many times, my actual working experience, when I go and meet the user has got a different problem, actually, which we may not have thought about it, actually. So we have to really understand what is the industry problem. The problems, if you look at it in the home, the architects and contractors will give you the problem. If you go to the industry, we have a Thana Manufacturer Association and TISA and all that. If you go to Ambernath, there are a number of process industries are there, and everybody has got a problems. So if you start discussing their problems, I'm quite sure our technology teams can really contribute it and develop some low-cost, simple, user-friendly solution, basically, to solve their problems, actually. And that is where things can really go on building it up. But I can really call it as a innovation hub, basically, no? Where it's a tripartite thing, is technology, management, and industry can come and contribute it and all that. And I'm always available to do whatever help is possible from you and all that. Just wanted to tell you, which I was, of course, directly, indirectly working on to this, actually, was talking about IoT. IoT is also getting extended to social, mobile, also artificial intelligence, which I mentioned it to you. And then the new area that's coming up is people have started talking about the Industry 4, basically. Now, what is this Industry 4? The industry revolution started in 17th century. We are moving to 1, 2, 3 and all that. And the Industry 4 is basically more onto the basis of IoT, which is really connecting the devices for improving the decision-making and support system. So this is what is a broad thought. I thought I will share with you. If anybody wants to have some few questions, I am open to share my thoughts. And
friends, audience, if you have any questions, we have Mr. Jayant Joshi to solve your problems or questions, any queries you can ask. Yes.
Given the answer, I want you to go onto YouTube or something where you will see the answers. Because at least you must make efforts to go and search it out the answers. What is interesting thing is not the answers, but then the robotics with artificial intelligence has reached to a stage where she can sense the question, do some analysis, and generate answers to you, basically. That is what is more important from our point of view, is basically.
I hope Darshan will do the homework today. Yeah.
Okay. India is constantly talking about the issue of unemployment.
Yeah.
So with more and more intelligence coming in with robotics and others, and we are grappling with this continuous issues of unemployment. So this Indian economic conclave, was there any issue about how are we going to engage this? Because you create these trillions in terms of wealth management, but the other wealth of people, are they also thinking from that management perspective? Means, was there any discussion on that? Means, I'm just thinking.
No, there was not a direct discussion, because it was basically covering all various areas of economics and all that, actually, starting from insurance, mutual fund to everything, actually. But I will share my ideas onto that, actually. This is what I actually am listening for last 30 years. Why we need a computerization? We already have people and they are generating the data, and we are maintaining the records and all that. If we do everything onto the computers, what jobs we will give to the clerks who are doing that thing and all that. In fact, it is basically our leadership, or we have to really explain it to them how their jobs will be simplified, how they will be able to have a correct and accurate data which can be used for a decision making. And with the decision making, how really we can build up a wealth, basically. Finally, what is that contribution from those people? You are going to save something that is going to generate money either for you or for a company. You utilize that money or invest it into something by which your expansion or something like that, or better facilities to improve still further. It's a cycle, actually. We talk about the continuous improvements and all that, which is really not happening it in many places, actually. And that's a basically a change management which is really required, which is the most important thing. And that's why, if you see, I'm always talking about the people, processes and technology. Normally everybody's talking about the technology and all that, but I always give third priority to the technology. We have huge number of technology companies. I don't want to name all them, but they are technology people. They don't really change the mindset of the people. And
Please. Prashna sahi sir ki when we talk about countries like US, Europe, probably their population is very less. And they have to depend on robots, example, because probably they don't have people to do it. But means I recently visited Volkswagen factory in Chakhan. Now, when I speak, talking to their HR head, they are actually forced to employ 40% of people. Otherwise, they are in a position to automate the entire factory without man.
Correct.
Now, if they don't employ 40%, our government is not allowing them to run the factory. Okay. This is the scenario. Because people need to be employed. People need to be engaged. That is my worry. Because if that 40% is a big number which is getting employment. So I'm just thinking, if they have the capacity of now, so many robotics thought process have already come in. So I'm just worried from that perspective, because India's strength is population. And if we don't work on that strength of population and we work on that strength which is US strength or European strength, then is there a challenge which we foresee in the another 5 years or 10 years?
Yeah, in fact, that is what I discussed about the training, and this is what was the Raghuram Rajan was also mentioning it. Now, our talents are to be upgraded. When I'm mentioning the talent, it's not only at a managerial level, it's a down level also, or at the shop floor level also. They should be also able to use and work with the robotics so that they can make best use of the robotic. And then their skills can be used into some other operations where it can be used. And that is how we will generate more employment, actually. It's our mindset that we employ robotics, so we will have less number of people. In fact, you can give more people. And today, why India is getting so much of a response from countries, basically because we have a huge manpower. Now, how we use effectively this manpower is our challenge, basically. Correct. Earlier also we were moving with the taxis and autos and all that, but Uber is giving satisfaction to the customer, generating the employments also. It's just, because of the employment, you buy new cars also. So the car sale is also going on, actually. So car sale means also the industries which are supporting to car manufacturing.
Now Google will come with a driverless car. Where, what will happen to all the drivers? That is my worry. That is my worry. Means my worry is only there.
No, okay. But at least cars will be there. So car selling will go up. So car manufacturing will go up. Car manufacturing will need a separate industry and all that.
Yeah, good morning, sir.
Yeah.
Joshi here. When we are talking about disruption of this technology and all these things, the advancement of technology, IoT is there, blockchain is, everything is there. Now, which are the skills that need to be acquired by the students? Which are the courses that need to be run by the institutions? Can you just throw light on this?
Yeah, in fact, that is what I was just mentioning it. I was mentioning it as a collaborative integrated approach and all that. I know the technology students are good, they are experts into the technology. But how the technology will be used into the industry? Now, industry is really not aware about how that IoT can contribute it. IoT people are not understanding what are the industry's problems and all that, actually. So they need to have a collaboration, and then, in fact, I'm working on designing a course syllabus for a management institute where they say that, how this emerging technologies and all can really benefit, what skills we should really teach to the students and all that. What I suggest is that they should have more industry interaction, basically, to understand the industry's problem. My idea of that innovation hub is from that angle only. And then again, the same thing I'm connecting with the managements also, because the management concepts are also to some extent to be taught to the students so that they know about it. So in a curriculum, you should some subjects like that. Actually, I know when I was doing my MBA, we had some one or two subjects into the management, but that was a very preliminary. Now things are changing, they are moving to a very fast thing and all that, actually. And the issues are becoming, the problems are becoming very complex. It's not something like only technology can solve a problem, or it's not something only management can solve a problem. So you need that integrated approach to solve that. So a combination of this can really help into improving onto that.
Is there any that industry should come forward that they need this skill so that we can run those courses and we can offer those courses to the students?
Okay,
there's a situation of you can say confusion as such.
Okay.
We are still not clear what exactly these skills are required.
Okay.
Today there is no dearth of employment, but the skill is required. But what exactly the skill is required? That is what we want to know.
Okay. Let me be very frank. I am not really aware about your technology syllabus at this moment of time, basically. But if I see, and we can sit down and see that what is it covering it and all, and we can go on working on to that. And again, I am again saying it. It's, I have a Windows manual, 1987 Windows 1. But has Windows stopped it? No, it's improving, it's changing. So it's the same way we have to really go on changing. We have to go on moving it out. No? We have to do some courses and then add some subjects and see how they are moving, interacting it. We have to also get a feedback from the customers. I'm always saying that it's a customer who is paying you and all that. Instead of we thinking about, we should do this, we should do that. We must also discuss with some industries and understand their problems, where it can help them, and where it can help even their working employees also, and then take it to the next level. So it's a continuum. Yeah, okay, thanks. Thanks a lot. Bye.